Okay, so now let's go ahead and think about what determines the level of net exports and net capital outflow. Because remember, net exports equals net capital outflow. There's two ways of looking at this, and we could either look at the net export side or the net capital outflow side. So, if we're going to look at the net export side, in the short run, something like tastes or fads or fashions can influence the level of a country's net exports. So if there's a boom for the type of coffee grown in Indonesia, that's going to help net exports in Indonesia and hurt net exports in Brazil as people reorient from one type of coffee to another. In the long run, these things aren't super important in determining the level of net exports from a country. Likewise, in the short run, swings in comparative prices influence net exports. So you can see if the United States is determined to import a certain amount of avocados from Mexico, and Mexico is determined to import a certain amount of corn from the U.S., then when avocado rice prices rise relative to corn prices, that's going to boost the Mexican exports to the U.S., and it's going to cause U.S. net exports to go down. And vice versa, if corn prices rise relative to avocado prices. And again, we think that this is mainly a sort of short-run phenomenon. Exchange rates. Movements in exchange rates basically affect things just like prices. And in the short run, we see actually sometimes what's called a J-shaped curve. And that's kind of a long explanation here. But the rough idea is that if the US dollar gets stronger, then in the very short run, the quantities that the US imports and exports don't change. So that we're going to go ahead and see that in the short run, US net exports may actually go up and measured in dollars. But in the longer run, actually, people will adjust to the fact that foreign goods have become cheaper, and they're going to go ahead and buy more. We're going to concentrate in the long run here. And so what we're going to say here is that, in general, and we'll talk about exchange rates more later, a stronger dollar is going to mean lower net exports, and a weaker dollar is going to mean higher net exports, because essentially a stronger dollar makes U.S. goods look more expensive to foreign buyers, so they're going to buy less, and a stronger dollar makes foreign goods look cheaper to U.S. consumers, so they're going to buy more, vice versa for a weaker dollar. So in the short run, we're not going to worry about this that much. Instead, we're going to concentrate on this long-run relationship. So, relative income growth. When a country has more income, it's going to see that it's going to demand more of the goods of all types, and some of those goods are produced overseas, and so that's going to tend to make its net exports lower. In the longer run, that's not such a big phenomenon. Something like transport costs. Actually probably don't play much of an impact on net exports, because of course transport costs affect both exports and imports, so they don't really affect the net exports, because they make both exporting and importing cheaper if they fall. And then finally, government policies, things like tariffs and various other trade restrictions or loosenings, we think these are mainly short-run influences. And so you'll notice here that sort of most of the things I have affecting the net export side of things, we think are short-run influences. And when we're looking at the entire economy, we instead tend to think about things in terms of these capital flows. So The big one that we think impacts relative capital flows is relative savings rates and relative investment levels. And in particular, remember that we had said that national saving equals investment spending plus net capital outflow, or we could equivalently say national saving equals investment spending plus net exports. Well, if we bring the investment spending over to the left-hand side, then we get equations that look like this. Savings minus investment equals net capital outflow or equals net export. So when a country has a high level of saving relative to its level of investment, then it's going to have positive net capital outflows. Or if it has a high level of saving relative to its level of investment, it's going to have positive net exports. So high saving means trade surplus. Low saving, and this is all relative to the level of investment, is going to mean a trade deficit. And when you think about that, that actually kind of makes sense. Because if a country produces a lot, but doesn't use a lot, what does it do with all the extra output? Well, it tries to sell it somewhere else, outside of its own country. And that generates a trade surplus. On the other hand, if a country wants to use a lot of stuff, but it doesn't produce very much, then it's going to have to import stuff to fill that gap between what it desires to use and what it actually produces. So this is the big fundamental long-run determinant. In the shorter run, we are going to go ahead and see that things like estimates of risk impact relative capital flows, so that if a country looks like it's going through a period where, I don't know, it might leave the euro, or it might have its government overthrown or something like that, then people are going to stop wanting to invest in that country. And in fact, many of the people who live in that country are going to try and move their money out of it. We could also have various government policies that could restrict capital inflows and that kind of stuff. This one almost always tends to be short run. This one, can sort of be short to medium run in its effect. But really, fundamentally, almost everything we think about net capital outflows and net exports comes back to this idea of relative savings rates, relative investment levels, and we could, as a corollary of that, look at relative interest rates. Because if you think back to something like a loanable funds model, savings relative to investment is going to tell you something about the supply of loanable funds relative to the demand for loanable funds, so that's going to tell you something about relative interest rates.